He said what he meant. He meant what he said. And every time you and I align ourselves with what heaven is speaking, you get an upgrade. Because the enemy is the father of lies. He's been continuing to lie to us from the beginning of time in order to throw us off from the very best that God has for us. But God, bless his name, he has sent his word to heal us and deliver us from our destruction, the psalm tells us. Wow. And so when you agree with his word, when you come into alignment, you take time to meditate on what God has said. I mean, you really seriously sit down and say, what did he say? What did he say? And you really think it through. Don't just read it. Think it. Meditate on it. Begin to speak it back out over your life, praying it out, declaring it, speaking it into your future. You will watch a transformation begin to happen inside of you. And you'll stop agreeing with the devil. Oh, I tell you, it's awful how much we agree with what the enemy has said. And then we get that fruit. But when you agree with God, it's unstoppable. He said, my word will not return to me void, but it will accomplish the purpose for which I sent it. Oh, yeah. Those are some of the most powerful times that I had. I had another powerful time this week where I really took some time with the Lord and was spending time in his word, just concentrating on the things that he had been saying to me. And the Lord just challenging me and saying, Paul, do you believe this? Do you believe this? Can you visualize this? Can you see it happening in your life? Is it the truth? And to say, yes, God, this is what is true. This is what is happening. This is where we're going. Ah, yeah. And my neighbors that were walking by the house probably thought there was a battle going on inside my home. I was beating my wife or something, you know, because I was literally screaming out in declarations concerning what God has for me and what he has for our church. You know, it's really easy to say the best is yet to come. But you need to understand that is warfare all the way. For you to have God's best in your life, that the best is yet to come, that you're going to be experiencing the things that only God can do, the things that are straight out of heaven, to have those things happening in your life in the days ahead at a level you have not yet experienced. Do you think Satan's going to sit back idly and say, oh, well? Oh, he's going to put up a little scrap, maybe a big one. But that's okay, because he's just a glutton for punishment. He's too dumb to figure out that those who are walking in the Spirit and walking with the Word, those who know their God, are going to run right over the top of him. But he's always willing to take the chance that there's some of us that aren't going to do that, and we're going to fall prey to some of those things. So we got to live in that place where we never accept the status quo on anything. We're very conditioned to do that. We've got to not do that. We have to challenge everything around us and just say, oh, yeah? Let's see about that. What does God have to say about that? Because he is in me and I am in him, it makes a difference on everything. A few weeks ago at Cowboy Church, I had shared the testimony of what Margie and I had seen happen at a very powerful meeting down in Butte, Montana, where a woman with a goiter, we watched that thing shrink in front of our eyes, under our hands. So I was just sharing that, and the prophecy is the testimony of Jesus. And so every time you share a testimony concerning what he has done, what he is doing, it can become a prophetic word for somebody else who needs something from God. And so after I shared that testimony, I just said, is somebody here have a thyroid condition? The Lord would just touch you right now. Because goiters are caused by a dysfunctioning thyroid. And there was a gal sitting there, and she said, "Well, I've got something going on right now. I'm supposed to have an operation." And she had a nodule that it had was growing in her, the throat area, because of the thyroid. And I said, "Well, what do you think God wants to do?" And she said, "I think He wants to deal with it right now." So a few people sitting around her laid hands on her, and we spoke to that thing, and she felt it shrink right there, sitting in her seat. I'm sorry you're so bored with that. I forget, we're Americans. It takes us a while to get past all of our cynical, unbelieving, scientific, medical junk in our heads, you know. We hear that stuff and we go, So I got a text from her this week. You want to hear this? Said, "Good morning. I just wanted to tell you, I just came back from my endocrinologist about my thyroid. And my thyroid is perfect. I just want to let you know that since we prayed over it at church, I have felt amazing. And that nodule is absolutely nothing. It's just this little itty bitty thing that means absolutely nothing." And then she puts a couple little hearts there. Said, and then she makes a statement, "God is so honest to His word." And she's going to share that at Cowboy Church tonight, her testimony, and her Mormon mother's going to be there. I tell you, God doesn't play fair, does He? See, the whole world is waiting to hear the good news. It's not good news if it doesn't change anything. He sent His word to heal them and to deliver them from their destruction. We began last week looking at Psalm 67. I want you to turn with me there real quick. We're just going to flip through a couple of verses. I want to continue on with a theme here that I believe is very important for us to have a handle on in the days ahead. You and I have been set up by God to be powerful in the earth in ways that we can't even imagine. Paul said the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God for the pulling down of strongholds. And strongholds come in lots of shapes and forms and expressions in people's lives. And you and I have an assignment. It's called destroy the works of the devil. 1 John 3:8 tells us about our Savior. He came to destroy the works of the devil. And if you and I are going to be a follower of Jesus, we have that assignment on our lives. Everywhere we go, the things that we see that the enemy doing, we have the opportunity to flip it upside down, or actually turn it right side up. Wow. And so God has given us many, many weapons. God has an end game plan for everything as He's getting ready to wrap up time here on the earth and send His Son Jesus back. And you and I are right in the center of this thing. It's so important that you are not sitting back passively on the sidelines just watching things happen. Sitting there saying, oh God, please keep me safe. Oh God, you know, rescue me. Oh Jesus, when are You coming back here? You know, this is getting a little rough here. No, you and I are supposed to be right in the thick of this thing with weapons of our warfare. Ladies, too. I can see some of you gals have one of those sticks with the, has that chain on one of those balls that's covered with spikes, you know, and you're just... Anybody gets near you, they get more than a shave. Psalm 67. God be gracious to us and bless us and cause His face to shine upon us. that your way may be known in the earth, your salvation among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God, let the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you will judge the peoples with uprightness and guide the nations on the earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God, let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its produce. God, our God, blesses us. God blesses us that all the ends of the earth may fear him. And I don't have time to review this. It's a message from last week's already online. I watched it again yesterday. It was good. But basically, in a nutshell, this is what we were talking about last week, is that God has an end game plan here. And that is that he's already made his decision. You and I have something that we need to do, and that is to position ourselves for this one who has loved us and said, I want to be gracious to you. I want to bless you. I'm going to cause my face to shine upon you. I'm going to cause the earth to yield its produce to you. I'm going to do all of these things for you to bless you, to bless you, to bless you. That means you and I are going to be under the favor of the Lord. We are under the favor of the Lord. And he is going to do for us what we cannot do for ourselves. El Shaddai is here. He's more than enough. He can take care of everything. And when God does it exceeding abundantly beyond what we could ask or imagine. Do not lose sight of the God factor. He likes to multiply. He likes to be explosive. He likes to just overwhelm us in the way that he does things. You and I still are not accustomed to the overwhelmingness of God in the way that he comes. I've come that you might have life and have it to the full, to the max. This is our God. God's plan in these last days is to come with demonstration of his graciousness, his blessing, his face shining on us, so that the nations of the earth can see what God is doing, and they will erupt in praise toward God. They will be drawn into something that has always been available for them, but they could not see it. But they begin to see it because they see you and they see me. So, I tell you, it's going to be fun to be just walking in this blessing from God. And I'm not saying it's all material. It's going to come in so many different ways. Just the sheer power that's flowing through your life to be able to change other people's lives. Healing the sick is a lot of fun. And then we looked at 2 Corinthians 9. I want you to turn there with me. And I want us to launch from there again this morning. Okay, we're paying very close attention to what God's Word says. If you have not yet decided, by the way, that the Word of God is absolutely true, that it is God's infallible rule for faith and practice, that it is a living, true, supernatural Word above all other things, then I don't know what you're going to do in the last days. You're going to need the Word of God. It is the only thing that has the power to change you. Okay. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, we're going to start with verse 6. Now I say this to you, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must do as he has purposed in his heart, not grudgingly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Now, here's where we really want to go. And God is able, El Shaddai is able to make all grace abound to you. There's that Psalm 67. So that you always having all sufficiency in everything, See, that's when God's face is shining on you and he's blessing you. That's what it looks like. All sufficiency in all things. Spend a week meditating on that. What does that look like when it happens in your life? So if you haven't even begun to try to imagine what that would look like in your life, you're probably not even going to see it when it begins to try to happen. You certainly won't be expecting it. But these things are written so that you and I will raise up our thoughts to the level of where God's thoughts are, and so that we will begin to have an expectancy for some things to begin to happen on a level that they've never happened yet in your life. See, that's part of our battle is we're used to this status quo. We're used to certain things operating in our lives at a particular level, and we tend to agree with the enemy that this is the limit. This is, you know, and we're working real hard to see maybe we can increase that just a little bit. But then you have God come into the middle of all that, and he says, all. He just blows the lid off of everything, and then you and I got to recalculate. All sufficiency in all things, that you may have an abundance for every good deed. As it is written, he who scattered abroad, he gave to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. And you will be enriched in everything for all liberality, which through us is producing thanksgiving to God. What is God's plan for you and I? What is this powerful weapon that we have been given? We've been called to change the world. We've been called to inform the world. Not just with words. Sometimes it's better for you just to shut up. Far better to let your life preach. Far better for people to see you sowing and reaping and seeing this multiplication factor that's operating over your life, where he is providing everything that you need, all sufficiency in all things for every good deed. God is supplying you. And in this, you are experiencing the increase of the harvest of your righteousness. There is a harvest that we talked about last week that God has for us, a harvest of righteousness, where what God is doing to me and what is flowing through me is producing righteousness in the earth, and it's causing God to be seen for who he really is. Romans 12, verse 2, tells us that when we refuse to be conformed to this world but be transformed by the renewing of our minds, we come into alignment with what God has said and who he is and what he's doing. What happens is that your life goes on to prove that God's ways, God's will, everything about him is good, acceptable, and perfect. You become the living proof in the earth. You become the living testimony in the earth that God is true. And to not have him as your God is foolish. That means that you and I have got to come up to another whole level. The church in America has got to come up to another whole level. We've got to be walking in this that Paul is talking about, this whole experience of sowing and reaping and God being gracious and God blessing and God shining his face on us, this outpouring. You and I, I'm going to just say it this way. You and I are not living yet at the level that we should be with God until we see other people giving thanksgiving and praise to God who would not otherwise have done so. That is the true test of whether or not you're walking under God's face shining on you. There should be something so dynamic happening in your life that other people who see you and meet you and experience you are provoked to respond to God in a way that they never planned on doing. It produces thanksgiving to God. That's why in Psalm 67 it says, let the peoples praise you. Let all the nations praise you. Heaven has a very clear picture of the entire world experiencing God. How is the world going to experience Him? God's plan is you and me. We're the ones who know Him. We're supposedly His children. We're supposedly supposed to be walking in the fullness of who Christ is in the earth, living as sons and daughters. Okay, so I'm throwing out the challenge to you and to me. I had to spend some time this week meditating on, so Paul, how are you doing in this arena? How many people are you provoking to thanksgiving? How many people are excited about God because of what He's doing in your life? So I've just become convinced it's not enough anymore for us just to run around and tell people about Jesus so they can go to heaven. Because if their life can't be changed here in this life, what's a heaven for? You and I are supposed to be a living testimony of the possibility of a greater heaven, because people are seeing dimensions of heaven on earth in our lives already. We are the proof that there is a heaven. I am so tired of trying to tell people, well, you should believe in God and you should believe that He has a heaven, and do you know where you would go tonight if you were to die? And they just look at you like, I'll be dead and I won't care. I say, well, don't you know there's a heaven and a hell? Well, there might be. And I spent all this time trying to convince them, and you know, you need to go see the movie 90 Minutes in Heaven. That'll prove it to you. No, the biggest proof that there is a God and that there is a kingdom of God and that there is a heaven is the fact that there are things that are unexplainable happening in your life. Paul told the Corinthians, when I came to you, I didn't come with a bunch of words. I came with a deliberate demonstration of the Spirit and of power. Why? So that your eyes would go, whoa, I've never seen that before. There must be something else beyond what I've understood. Now this pulls us into this whole arena of what I want to address this morning, and it's called good deeds. What did Paul say here? He said he will give you an abundance. He'll give you everything that you may have that abundance for every good deed. Did you know that we're called as believers not just to believe, but we are also called to reflect who God is and reflect the heaven that we're a part of by releasing the things of heaven through our lives in the earth? The Bible just calls that good works or good deeds. Acts 10:38. Peter is preaching to Cornelius and his family and friends, and he's telling him about Jesus. And here's what he said about Jesus in a nutshell. He said, you know how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. And what did he do with that Holy Spirit and power? He went around doing good and setting free all those who were oppressed of the devil. Part of the proof that you have the Holy Spirit, part of the proof that there's power on your life, part of the proof that God is dwelling inside of you is what's coming out of you that is touching other people. That there really is a difference in your life and the way that you relate to other people. Your actions change. Your words change. You are now releasing something flowing through you that has a God impact on somebody else's life. Ephesians 2:10. We like the Ephesians 2:8 and 9, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, so forth. It's a free gift from God. For Yeah, we like to camp out there at the grace side of what God did for us, but here's where it goes. For we are his workmanship. See, the purpose of grace, the purpose for you being born again in the first place, is so that you could now become this brand new creation. We now are his workmanship. The Greek word is poema, from which we get the word poem. We are this creation that is unfolding. It's like a piece of art. It's this expression of heaven. A letter from God's heart to the world. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. For what? For good works. So many people don't understand that when they came to Jesus, that something dramatic and dynamic happened to them in heaven. You got put back on God's table, on his workbench, on his easel, whatever you want to say. And he began to recreate you. There's a force of heaven that is now working over our lives to do in us what we cannot do for ourselves, to become what we could never make ourselves, to do through us what we could never produce. We're his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. If any man be in Christ, he becomes a new creature, new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Created in Christ Jesus for, and this is so straightforward, for good works. Where do these works come from? Well, he tells us. Works that God created, set aside before the foundation of the world, that you should walk in them. Okay, so I want you to see this picture. I've come to Jesus. I've been born again by the Spirit of God. He has made me a new person entirely. The most real thing about me now is the divine nature of God that I have received within myself to be fully like him. I may still be in this flesh, but now my flesh becomes a vessel, it becomes a servant to the purposes of God. And God, who is looking at me at this time in history, he knew me before the foundation of the world. He already saw me. He already chose me. He already predestined me to come to him. And as he knew me and he saw me, he also saw all of these works that were going to be bundled around my life that were going to reflect who he is. I was born for a purpose. I was born to give glory to God. I was born to be a son and daughter whose life just keeps releasing, keeps emanating the reality of heaven, the reality of my Father. Jesus said, when you've seen me, you have seen my Father. The works that I do, I didn't originate them of myself. He said, apart from him, I can do nothing. But the works that I'm doing, I got them from my Father. I'm just like my Father. I only do what I see my Father doing. I only say what I hear my Father saying. Jesus himself, as he walked the earth, was walking in things that the Father had already foreordained for him before he ever showed up on the planet. He was the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world. Are there things that are already true about you and I? Things written in God's book about us before we ever showed up in the womb. If those things are already true about us, if they've already been written in heaven, as God has looked upon us and looked upon our lives and he said, oh, what I'm going to do with this person when my Spirit gets on them, when they are born again, born from heaven. They become the very temple of the Holy Spirit, receive my Spirit without measure. Angels are ascending and descending on their lives as they walk under an open heaven. They are in Christ. Ooh. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That means that God, who has already formed me, already chosen me, already clustered all of these works around my life, so that I then become a living fulfillment of a destiny that looks just like Him. That people see Him. They experience Him. Good works. God works. You see, it's not just that we come up with some good ideas of how to be nice to people. But we're actually living out a destiny of redemption. First, it started with us, what He did for us, what He did to us to redeem us from the one who came to steal, kill, and destroy. And He pulled us out of the kingdom of darkness where we were children of wrath. And He brought us into the kingdom of His dear Son, where we become sons and daughters now of the living God, adopted into the family. And He glorified us. And having done all of that to us, He sets us on a course to hear His voice. We know we've been redeemed. We know something incredible has happened to us that only God can make happen. We live in this eternal gratefulness of this grace that saved a wretch like me. But it doesn't stop with us. We have this understanding that what He's done to me, He can do through me to touch somebody else. I was born for a redemptive purpose. I was born to destroy the works of the devil. I was born to extend the kingdom of God, His rule and reign, touching people. I want to have us read a few verses here. 1 Peter. I got to catch my breath. Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles, so that in the thing in which they slander you as evildoers, they may, because of your good deeds, as they observe them, glorify God in the day of visitation. I'm going to read one more time. This is a revealed strategy from heaven over our lives. How many of you know if you got the strategy of heaven, you're going to win? God never loses. Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles. Now, we would just say that watch how you are living. Word, deed, attitudes, everything about your life when you're amongst the non-believers, those who do not know God. Is that just a smart idea? That's called being responsible. Freely I've received, I owe God a big favor. You can't bring the good news and be the bad news. Have you ever met somebody who was bad news? Was it fun? No. Every time we run into attitudes, actions, words that are not loving, that they're selfish, they're full of whatever's come out of darkness, brokenness and fear and the need to control. And we are never happy after we've run into that person. How sad that a non-believer would meet a believer in Jesus. I saw this on Facebook a couple days ago. I can't remember who posted it, but there was somebody sitting in traffic. They'd come up to they're approaching a yellow light, and they, instead of trying to run through the yellow light, they decided to just approach it, you know, slowly, and then just stop in time. Unfortunately, the person behind them was not happy with that plan, because they wanted to get through the light, and so they were hoping this person was going to race through so they could race through behind it, because they're in a hurry. because this person in front was doing this, the person in back started hitting their horn, rolled down their window, started screaming all kinds of stuff at them, and, you know, just foul language, everything, you know, what, you idiot, what are you, you know, all those. But suddenly a policeman walks up to the person's window. He had just happened to be parked off to the side, and says, "Get out of the car." Arrested this woman right on the spot. It was a woman. Arrested right on the spot, and took her to jail. You would think, wow, that's strange. You know, just you go to jail just for do it. No. Took her to jail. After she's spent a little time there, an hour in jail, the officer comes and gets her out and says, "I'm so sorry, ma'am. I didn't realize who you were. You see, I saw the bumper stickers on your car that said all this stuff about Jesus and all the rest, and saw that little fish symbol on the back of your car, and I just knew for sure you must have stolen that car, that it didn't belong to you." You never know who's watching, do you? You never know who's experiencing you. So Peter says, let them experience something amazing when they meet you. So that in the thing in which they slander you as an evildoer, and I'll tell you, we're going to have a lot of people throwing mud at us in the days ahead. There's one way to shut them up. Prove them wrong. They may, because of your good deeds, as they observe them. Notice the word observe. Not everybody's going to get it right away. You can say, "Hey, I'm innocent," and all the rest. But it's what people see of you over the long haul. It's what your neighbors watch as they live next to you day after day, month after month, year after year. That coworker, they're taking you in every day. Those other family members that don't know God. We're being experienced by people constantly. And Peter said, if their experience of you is something amazing that looks like God, feels like God, smells like God, good deeds, things that you're doing that reflect heaven, things that you're doing that reflect what's been done to you by God Himself. He said, when they experience that, because of your good deeds as they observe them, they will glorify God in the day of visitation. I don't know exactly what Peter means by in the day of visitation, but it seems to indicate that there is a time set aside for them to have an encounter with God, and you are going to be the catalyst that's going to push them over. Because of what? They observed your good deeds, not because they received your good preaching. Maybe that's going to help too, but I tell you, your deeds better match your words. Your driving better match your bumper stickers. Okay. So Jesus said it this way, Matthew 5, in the Sermon on the Mount, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house." We'll stop right there. God's plan is for you and I to be right out in the open, very plainly seen, reflecting who He is. As He causes His face to shine upon you, you get to out there for everybody else. We're called to live very deliberately out in the open, reflecting what's happening to us. We're experiencing Him being gracious and blessing us. And there should be continual praise already coming out of our lives if we expect it from them. He said, you are the light of the world. Then he says this, let your light so shine before men that they may see what? Your good works, your good deeds. And do what? Glorify your Father in heaven. Do you see the connection? God really believes that you and I, if we're truly born again, truly carrying the Spirit of God, being blessed by Him, walking in this amazing relationship with Him, that there's going to be something very loud and bright about our lives that are going to get the attention of other people, even while they're cursing you, even while they're persecuting you, rejecting you, saying, I don't want your Jesus, they still can't escape from what they see. They can't escape from what they keep experiencing of the love that you're throwing out there. They can't help but notice that you aren't doing what other people do. That you're not moving towards take care of me first, you later. Sorry about you. But rather, you seem to put them first before you take care of yourself. That you seem to be very content. You seem to act like you have more than enough. You seem to act like you are rich and abounding in something. And you're so liberal in your generosity and in the way that you treat people and the way you talk to them and what you're believing about them. Yet you're the one person in their life that's actually saying something nice about them when everybody else thinks they're garbage. That's one of the powers of a prophetic word. When you come and you tell somebody how God sees them before they actually become it, God sees you this way. They go, wow, wait, me? Yeah. And the proof of it is what He did in my life. Because God calls those things that are not as if they are. Okay, do you get the way this works? Timothy, or Paul told Timothy in chapter 6, he said, instruct those who are rich in this present world not to be conceited or to fix their hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. Instruct them to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, storing up for themselves the treasure of a foundation for the future so that they may take hold of that which is life indeed. Your good works ultimately are going to be rooted in your ability to see the connection of what you're doing with what's happening in heaven at the moment and what is going to be released in heaven later. You and I are not called to just look at things according to, we're operating according to our own power, and we're looking at just earthly circumstances and judging by earthly standards on what we think somebody deserves or whatever else. We are living in connection with heaven's attitude towards things, which is a redemptive attitude. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. He didn't come to condemn the world, but to save it. As you and I see ourselves as a redemptive saving force in the earth, I am salt. I am light. I touch things. I change things. I release things. We're entering into a sowing and a reaping and the increase of the harvest of our righteousness in everything that we're doing. Whether somebody receives what you're doing or not, whether they appreciate it or not, it doesn't matter. Because what you're doing, Paul said it this way, whatever you do in word and deed, do everything for the glory of God. I think he said that in the context of talking to some slaves about serving their masters. the non-Christian masters who were not treating him well. I've shared this story occasionally over the years. I felt like I should share it again this morning. This is a true story out of China many, many years ago. There were these two Christian brothers who had a rice farm. And it was on one of these terraced hills, you know, and you have to build all these dikes and do all this stuff to be able to contain the water. And, you know, it takes, if you know anything about rice, the first stages of growing rice takes a lot of water. They stay submerged. And so what these brothers had to do is they had to keep filling up these areas, or rice paddies, you know, fill them up with water continually. But they were living in a time where there wasn't water that you pump or irrigating. Everything was done by hand. They had to go down the hill, down to the river, carry up buckets, very heavy buckets of water, all day long just to fill the rice paddies. So they had done this one day, filled them all up. At the end of the day, they're just absolutely bone tired. They get up the next morning to find out that their fields have been completely drained out into their neighbor's fields. He had come in the middle of the night, broke down the wall between their fields, drained all of their water into his fields. If you're them, how do you feel? You know where your flesh is going to go. You're already thinking about, where did I put my gun? They knew he was not a Christian. So they thought, well, we're called to forgive. So they rebuild the wall between their fields. They go back, they fill up their fields, do the whole thing the next day. They wake up the next morning to find the exact same thing. Everything that they had done was drained into the neighbor's field. This goes on for a couple of days. You know, and they're doing this. Now, Jesus said, how many times do we forgive before we kill? But see, they're saying, we have no way to stop this guy other than to do what the world would do. And so they're getting more angry, they're getting more disheartened, they're saying, and you know, and their prayers are along the lines of, God, when are you going to kill him? When are you going to, you know? And as they're praying, God speaks to them and says, I'll tell you what to do. And they weren't expecting this answer. Fill his fields first. Oh, God, that's a dumb idea. But they knew it was God. So they rebuild the wall, and they're filling his fields. And when you're first doing that, you just feel like, what a waste of time. This guy is not going to appreciate this. He's done all these awful things to us. He doesn't deserve this. And I am breaking my back to bless this guy who has ripped me off over and over again. But they keep filling his field. And as they're going through the day filling his field, they start realizing what they're doing. They're doing what Jesus would do. They're doing what is the opposite of the flesh. They're doing what love looks like. And they start thinking about how they are actually blessing him. And as they begin to connect heaven's reality to everything that they were doing, bucket by bucket by bucket up that hill, their joy starts to increase. Pretty soon they're excited. It's like, God, look what we get to do for this man. So they fill his fields, and then they go and fill theirs. Twice as much work. They wake up the next day, having slept really good, and the neighbor comes over, and he's crying, and he said to them, I've always known that you men were Christians, and I've despised you, I've thought you were a bunch of fools, but what I watched you do yesterday was the very first time I've ever seen what Jesus really looks like. And he said, how can I know this Jesus that would cause you to be like that to me? And they led him to the Lord. True story. I've never forgotten that story. And there's something about that. You know, the weapons of our warfare are not always just going up into the heavens and prophesying and releasing and praying about things. Sometimes it's something so simple, so practical as what would love do? What does love look like in this situation? What is redemptive? Freely I've received. How do I freely give? How do I bless this person? How do I cause them to experience God's love in the way that I've experienced it? How do I cause them to feel valuable and worthy of attention and goods that I would give to them? Whatever it is that God might show you. There are so many verses in the New Testament where Paul speaks over and over again, and Jesus did it well as well, where he just said, focus on good deeds. Pour your life into good deeds. Spend time thinking about, calculating, strategizing how you're going to release more through your life, through which God is going to be speaking. He's going to be yelling into people's hearts. Because there are some hearts out there that are so hard and so broken that the only thing that's going to penetrate is something that you do. And Jesus said, it might even be just giving a cup of cold water in my name. I think sometimes we just complicate all this way too much. And we don't do the most simple, basic thing, and that is, Lord, you have loved me. How do I love other people? You have blessed me. How do I bless others? I'm sowing. I'm reaping. I've got this abundance from you. How do I just turn around and give it away again? How do I just pour it into somebody else's life? I watched a video a few weeks ago of a this guy who was, he was like a stealth bomber in the grocery store. And what he would do is he would come up in line behind somebody at the cash register. Somebody he knew that probably, and he went to a store where it was in a poor area of town. And he would stand in line and he would wait for them, for their bill to be tallied up, and the cashier would just say, this is what you owe. And he would suddenly step up and throw down money on the counter and say, this is for that, and then tell the person, God really loves you, have a great day, and then he'd run out the door. And they had a camera that was hidden, and it was absolutely stunning how many people broke down crying at the register and said, oh my God, who was that? Doesn't matter who it was. They got bombed from heaven with something that they weren't expecting. Can you imagine how the guy who was running out the door, how he was feeling? Got another one! You know, they couldn't get the money back to him because he ran. He didn't stand there to say, oh, yes, I'm so magnanimous, yes. Or to try to explain Jesus to them or whatever. All he just said, God sees you. He loves you today. Have a great day. And before they know it, their bill is paid. It's blown away. It was so fun to watch that video. I know some of you here, you've been in coffee shops where you paid for the person's drink behind you and they didn't even know it. That's fun, isn't it? There are so many creative ways that God can use us to touch other people's lives. And we've got to be very good at this. We've got to create an avalanche of so many good works that the devil can't stop it when it's coming down. Okay, I'm done. So let's stand. How many of you realize we can all do this? But I would say that actually the absence of this in our lives is actually robbing our own joy. We're becoming a conduit that's plugged up, where what's being given to us can't flow through us. And then we're not giving God much to work with. But when you begin to start thinking redemptively, you begin to start thinking about, you know, what you have that you can give. That's what Peter and John said to the guy at the temple gate. Very simple. We don't have silver and gold. You're asking for that. We don't have that. But what we do have, what we do have. And we need to never underestimate what we, the little that we have that we can give away. And God can multiply. But what's so exciting is he said, you do that, you start sowing like that, guess what I'm going to do? I am going to just start this cycle in your life where you're going to have an abundance for every good deed. And while all that's going on, you are increasing the harvest of your righteousness, which is going to follow you into heaven with great reward. Oh, yeah. I believe if you'll take time to meditate on these things this week, God's going to give you astounding ideas. But you won't do it unless you change how you see yourself. You are a weapon in God's hands. You are called by the Lord. Created in Christ Jesus for all of these good works that he prepared for you beforehand. You've already been set up. That means that the things that you're going to go into this day and the next day, where you're going to have an opportunity to do something, God set you up in advance, and here's angels already on the spot while it's happening, empowering something to happen that you can't make happen, to turn the heart of a person that otherwise would never be turned. But he's got you and he's using you. And you're just stepping into the things that he sets you up for. Okay, Lord, here we are again. Trying to be your people. We declare, Lord, that you have made us to be new creations, created in Christ Jesus for good works. Lord, we want to step up to the plate here. We want to believe what you believe so that we can do what you do, so that we can have what you say that we can have, so that we can turn around and give it away again and just start this process. Lord, we're looking for the increase of the harvest of our righteousness by which you will be glorified through our lives. Lord, make us to be the light of the world. Well, you already have. Cause us to stand up and shine. Cause us to be deliberate about who we are and what we have, and that people would see our good works. People would see Jesus all over us. And they would thank you. They would praise you. They would give glory to you in the day of their visitation. And Lord, can we just pray for a moment for all those that we're going to run into this week? Just say, Lord, just start praying for everyone that God's going to set you up to run into this week, whom you're going to have an impact on. Pray for their day of visitation. Yes, Lord, set them up, God. Let them see so clearly who you are. Lord, let that love and that light just pierce through the hardest heart, the most confounding lie that has controlled their lives, and open their eyes and bring them into that place of rejoicing because they have seen you, experienced you, and can know you. Now, Father, we're asking you as a church that you will begin to give us a harvest of souls, a harvest of people that do not yet know you, because they meet us and they experience us, and they've never been touched with so great a love. Father, we're just laying claim to all of these folks that are the harvest of our righteousness, that would be standing here with us in the days ahead. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Can we just lift up a shout of praise to the Lord for this?
Yes, Lord. Do it, God. Do it, Lord. Fulfill it, Lord. Make it happen, God. Woo!
All right, well, turn to the person next to you and say, the Lord bless you and keep you.